things you do not need. And I'm not talking about the new and shiny things. I'm talking about the legacy that you collect during multiple terms and multiple renewals. Even between renewals, if you don't have a day-to-day some program, if you don't keep your hand on the pulse of your IT, you don't have some processes, then it's inevitable that there's going to be some sort of a dead weight. And this could be either in desktops or on the server side. Licenses are being bought, not being used. They just sit there. If you just renew what you have, you will be renewing software assurance maintenance on licenses that you don't use. And it might be that you won't buy the necessary licenses that you might need. This is the so-called technical optimization. This is all about not renewing the licenses you don't need, but remembering that some of those licenses may actually be reused in the cloud and Azure. If you don't understand all the intricacies of this, don't try and solve it yourself without understanding how this all works, all the aspects of Microsoft licensing. Engage with your IT. Talk to them. Gather the data. See if the licenses match the requirements. And not just for today. What is it going to look like in the next 3 years? Where are you going to? Are you going to deploy new farms? This is why I'm saying you need to talk to your IT. Engage with your outsourcers. If you have a lot of outsourcers, get them on board well prior to the renewal. Start this exercise of understanding if you have anything you do not need, because otherwise you'll renew a say on that and you'll keep paying maintenance for the next 3 years for the licenses you're not using. Why would you do that? At some point, invite SMEs, licensing SMEs, someone from the outside world, your partner, and let them look at that data and let them give you more in-depth advice. People who do this on a daily basis, they know how to navigate the treacherous waters of Microsoft licensing. And then obviously, when you see there is fat, there is dead weight you don't want to carry over, then with the same teams, plan what can you do before renewal and what can you do after and when. If you do this properly, that will result in better savings, less costly, more optimized renewal. So what was compared is licenses, not instances 7, licenses to active instances. And 60% of the licenses were not in use. And customer kept buying them, renewing maintenance, software assurance on those licenses. They just piled up, snowballed to that quantity. There was an exercise to right size the renewal. We found that the percentage of unused licenses was quite large. Sat down at the table with the people from technical teams and looked at what they're planning to do. And what they were planning to do in the next 3 years is to migrate everyone from project on-premises to project online. It was already an ongoing project. The same with Visio. And why would you then renew maintenance on project and Visio? And here, please be careful. I was asked today to be careful with this message. Right now, I'm just talking about project and Visio. So there are very few benefits of software assurance of maintenance that apply to project and Visio. One of them is critical. It helps licensing working from home. Probably nowadays, it may be critical. So assess that. Look at that. But in this particular circumstance, in that year, there was no COVID. Everybody was working from the organization, from on-premises. The only other benefit of software assurance, of maintenance, was upgrade rights. There was no need to upgrade because they were migrating online. The first bill of material from the reseller, even without that knowledge, was offered as transition to Office 365. Just don't renew your site. You have 1,000 licenses. What they were offered in the renewal is 1,000 subscriptions for Project and Visio. We don't need that many. The second bill of material just had renewal of SA. What they did in the end, they just canceled software assurance. Completely canceled it because that doesn't cancel perpetual licenses. Users could still use those instances that they were licensed for. They canceled software assurance. They locked price on Project Online and Visio Online. For that price fix, you only need to buy one subscription, one user. You lock it for all the rest. Then you buy as needed. That migration is going on. Your users are still using on-premises project, but they're migrating, slowly migrating online with the pace that is comfortable to you. There's no non-compliance. There's no violation of anything. And in this particular case, six figures are saved. It's not bad, is it? Service are usually neglected. Oh, enterprise agreement renewal. Let's just look at how we could optimize Office. Maybe it's because it's difficult. Maybe because there's a lot of resistance from server teams. Very few people talk about service. But there are sometimes substantial savings in the server part, bigger in percentage comparison to what you can achieve on desktops. Don't neglect service. Service are important. During the assessment, preparation for the renewal, customer and SMEs, they looked at the server farms and they identified some server farms that could have been decommissioned. They were actually planned to be decommissioned, but for some reason they were still running. They were consuming licenses, electricity and all that. Obviously, and because that's always found, if you don't have an ongoing SAM program, there was a non-compliance on certain licenses, which needed to be addressed. When you address non-compliance, there are various ways how to do it in an optimal way. And as usual, again, over-licensing was found, licenses that the organization had, but wasn't using, wasn't planning to use on-premises. But the other thing that was very important here is that that organization had an ongoing migration of applications to Azure, like a five-year plan of what's going to be migrated, which service, how many servers, what were the plans for Azure, also taken into account. And why? If you have a surplus of licenses, I wouldn't cancel them until I review if I could reuse them in my upcoming Azure projects. Because the discounts that you get through renewing maintenance on your on-premises licenses, which gives you a right to take those licenses and deploy them in the cloud in Azure, that discount that you get for on-premises licenses, you will never get in Azure. And if you combine it with discount on the reserved instances, the savings on Azure become very substantial, very palpable. What you should do when you assess this, if you do it yourself, look at the on-premises, where there's waste, where there's non-compliance, but always have Azure migrations in mind, especially if you're a public sector organization, because that discount that you get through the public sector discounts, you will never get it on Azure. Even with government discounts on Azure, it's not comparable. Your so-called unused licenses may be actually very valuable. They may provide you a source of potential future savings. So think about that. Always take this into account. What they did is before renewal, because that's important. They accelerated decommissioning of the server farms, of those unused farms, and they reallocated all the resources, support fees to new shiny farms that were about to be deployed after the enterprise agreement renewal. But those licenses were reharvested. The other thing what they did, if you're on licensing, you may be aware, but if you're not in licensing, you may not be aware. This is not something that is obvious. In an enterprise agreement, you have this possibility of stepping up the edition. I'll try and make it as simple as possible. If you have licenses of a lower edition, say standard, you don't need this license, but you need licenses for data center edition, which is a bit higher, you can just pay the difference. That is only available through enterprise agreement step-ups, so-called step-ups. So this is what they used, therefore saving on proper upgrade of licenses. And they also planned at renewal too, and they did that, to renew licenses that will be reused at Azure. In addition to about 1 million per year spent on maintenance on software assurance, what they also got is a substantial reduction of a true-up. Because I need to remind you, because this is missed very often. When you renew your enterprise agreement, your previous term ends, and you still have the obligation for the previous term to true up your licenses. You have to first pay for all the licenses you've already used, you already deployed, and only then renew. Therefore, if you finish your migrations before that, if you finish your optimization before that, you have that potential to also save money on the true-up, which may be quite substantial. And this is a real-life example. When we spoke to IT people about all these farms being decommissioned and things optimized, what they did is they quickly jumped to their Excel spreadsheets and started putting in the numbers. What were those numbers, I wondered? What they were calculating is how much they can save or reallocate on the legacy farm support that they were paying to an outsourcer. They were craving for that money, and we gave them that plan that you can get rid of this. In large organizations, the communication between the teams could be broken. And sometimes a licensing SME could be that glue that ties all these things together, all the strings together. Suddenly that information reaches the right people, and they may find something through that license optimization exercise they didn't even think about. Again, real life example. If you like what you've just seen, please send me a connection request on LinkedIn. The link is in the description. And please subscribe to this channel so you do not miss any of the future updates and any of the future live shows that I upload here at least weekly. Thank you, and safe with knowledge of Microsoft licensing.